So the first quarter is, this is a semi-road male having painless limb. So you have 10 seconds to majority have given the right diagnosis. It's leg calf perfis disease. So what we see is, we see that there is a deformed femoral epiphysis. There is widening of the joint space. There is fragmentation and sclerosis of the femoral epiphysis. So this occurs due to some ischemic event during childhood, and it is its prognosis is actually varied. So the earlier the diagnosis, so femoral head with proper treatment can come back into the shape. So this is the proax lateral view. It shows that the anterior part of the head is more involved rather than the posterior one. So the differential diagnosis you need to keep in mind is major dysplasia, but it occurs in younger child, usually by 1.5 to 2 years of age, and it has a fragmented epiphysis, but it doesn't show collapse the head, and usually it resolves by itself. So it is a rather a delayed ossification of the femoral epiphysis of the head. So an epiphyseal dysplasias can also present with a ischemic insert, but then they usually have associated findings like short trunk and short stature, etc. So this is the spotter. Double PCL sign is okay. Bucket handle tear. Okay. What is the no ACL tear. Okay. So this patient is an athlete with pain knee joint and difficulty in walking. We have three signs. So we have double PCL sign, then we have this fragmented notch sign, and then we have this anterior flip fragment sign in which the anterior horns get thickened. And this anterior flip fragment sign is usually seen with the, is usually seen in the is seen in the lateral meniscus bucket handle tear, because due to the ACL, the meniscus is not able to go into the notch. So first, these two signs are seen with the medial meniscus bucket handle tear. So this is a lucent lesion in the proximal fibula. So it's a metaphyseal lesion. So you see that the epiphysis is spared. So it's not a germ cell, it's not a giant cell tumor. So it is an expansile lytic lesion, and it is, you see that it is not reaching till the epiphyseal plate. So, and moreover, so this is, so this is an aneurysmal bone cyst, not a giant cell tumor. So the differential diagnosis would be to consider would be the simple bone cyst and a non-ossifying fibroma. Again, a non-ossifying fibroma is a cortical lesion, and usually doesn't cause doesn't expand the bone. And the simple bone cyst again doesn't expand, and usually you can see a fallen fragment sign within a simple bone cyst. So the next part is a child having difficulty in standing and walking. Yes, I'm having a low battery in the PC, so I'll take just a minute. It's not scurvy. It's not scurvy. So I'll be back in a while.
शेयर, उसको शेयर बंद कर दो।
So this is the rickets of the right knee. So we can see that it is fraying and widening of the metaphysis and is widening of the growth plate. So it's not scurvy. It's the sorry about that. There was some glitch in the
Manish laptop. You are not audible.
Yeah, now sir, now
you're audible.
Yeah.
Now
you're audible. So, there's a certain glitch in the laptop, so I have to shift on the iPad actually. So now it's audible.
Yeah, it is coming fine.
It's audible, please carry on.
Yeah, majority of the people have answered it correct. So this is an osteochondral lesion of the medial talar dome. So we can see that is a non-displaced fragment, and there's a subchondral cystic change, and also there is a merodema. On PD fat set image, you can see there is a lot of merodema associated with the lesion. There's articular margin irregularity. However, there's no displaced fragment into the joint. So we classify it according to the Bendon and Harry stage. It is depends upon according to the stage, like merodema stage 1, then cystic marrow subchondral cystic stage is stage 2. So in this patient, this is stage 2 with undisplaced fragment. Okay, the next spotter, are you able to see? Yeah, good. The diagnosis is correct. So which sign is this? Yeah, this is candle wax dripping sign. So we can see there's a hyperostosis, or there's a along the cortex, and it is not circumferential. It's along the one side of the cortex. So usually it is secondary to the scleratome distribution of the spinal accessory sensory nerve, which is thought to be considered to be the etiology of this deposition of the bone along the cortex, or the dense ossification, the segmental ossification of the long bone. So your diagnosis is correct. So now spotter 8. Yeah. So what is the sign? The diagnosis is correct. Yeah, it's a metaphyseal band sign. So again, there was a child who was treated with home remedies for stomachache. Usually the home remedies contain lead, so which can lead to the lead intoxication or plumbism in these kind of children. So again, the differential diagnosis is quite wide. So the dense broad metaphyseal band usually can be a normal variation. It can be seen with healing rickets or hypervitaminosis D. It can be seen with the hypoparathyroidism, or it can be seen in the as well as transplacental infection. So the differential diagnosis is quite wide, but we need to have a correct history to make a proper etiological diagnosis. Yeah, this was the easy one. So everyone has answered it correctly. So we can see the ground glass matrix. It is involving the frontal bone. So this is the classical case of fibrous dysplasia. Again, fibrous dysplasia can have varied appearance. It can have a appearance from a lytic to a sclerotic to a sclerotic appearance. Okay, spotter 10. This is 55-year-old man who has presented with arthralgias and palpable bilateral elbows lesions. Yeah, gout. Yeah, again the diagnosis is correct one. So which, so it's a tophaceous gout. So we see the soft tissue swelling in the region of olecranon bursa along with a bony fragment, and there's a on the right side the enthesocyte is also present. So the correct diagnosis is tophaceous gout. Again, differential diagnosis, rheumatoid nodules can be kept, but then there's no other joint involvement because rest of the joints is absolutely fine. There's no lytic lesion seen. Okay, spotter. Spotter 11. So majority of you have answered correct. These are the varied appearance of osteoid osteoma. So the osteoid osteoma, we see a lucent lesion with a hyperdense nidus, radiodense nidus. So in the usually it occurs in the cortex, but when it occurs around the joints in a juxtaarticular area, it won't cause sclerosis. So an appearance of a radiolucent area with a central opaque focus without bone sclerosis can be osteoid osteoma. And then in the long bones, there will be a lot of cortical sclerosis associated with this nidus. And in quite a few of cases, you won't be able to see the nidus as well. And it may be difficult to differentiate from osteomyelitis. And many times a periosteitis can also be seen with the osteoid osteoma. Okay, spotter 12. Yeah. So majority of you have made the correct diagnosis. So this is the GCT fibula. So the previous lesion which was shown in the fibula was the enrosmal bone cyst. So now in here you can see that the lesion is reaching through the articular surface. Almost the lesion is predominantly epiphyseal. So majority of you have answered it correctly. Again, the differential diagnosis of epiphysealytic lesions, you need to keep in mind any infection, giant cell tumor, chondroblastoma. Rarely, eosinophilic granuloma and ABC can be kept in differential, but usually if these four criteria are present, then the definite differential diagnosis is giant cell tumor only. So the zone of transition should be narrow, and there should be non-sclerotic margins, then epiphyses are closed, eccentrically placed, and the lesion is epiphyseal and it bursts articular surface. So these, if all these features are present, it is very typical of a giant cell tumor. Okay, spotter 13. Yeah. So what is the appearance? What is the appearance of the vertebra? No, not codfish. Codfish, this is not a codfish vertebra. Yeah. This is a so we can see there is an anterior beaking mid in the vertebral body, the anterior margin in the mid, there is the beaking anterior protrusion. And there's the biconvex configuration. So this is referred to as a bullet-shaped or ovoid vertebra. Again, it can be seen with mucopolysaccharidosis, pseudoachondroplasia, and congenital hypoparathyroidism. Okay, spotter 14. So one is an asymptomatic young male, and another one is a middle-aged adult male with pain lower limbs. So these are the varied presentations of a Paget disease. So again, Paget disease is divided into the hot phase and the cold phase. Usually the hot phase is asymptomatic and there is a well-defined lytic lesion and it has an appearance of like a flame-shaped pattern, which is quite peculiar to this disease. So when you see this pattern, the Paget disease can be kept as a first differential. And again, the second one is again that this cotton wool appearance type, this process, then there's lytic lesion and there's the progressive margin inferiorly, which is again a lytic appearance. So the distal margin is an advanced lytic edge. So again, the differential diagnosis to be kept is again the benign lytic lesions like fibrous dysplasia can be kept in the hot phase and the chronic osteomyelitis can be kept in the cold phase. So last quarter. Yeah, George has made the correct diagnosis. So this is a case of, okay, punctata, there's also something else also. Which type of chondrodysplasia punctata? If you see correctly, can you see the bones? What about the femurs and what about humerus? So if you see that the humerus and the femur shortened, see. So this is a rhizomelic type of chondrodysplasia punctata. You see that there is punctate calcifications and the epiphyses of long bones, carpotarsal region and patellar regions. There is again the metaphyseal flaring and the ilia broad and sciatic notches are smaller. So this is a classical case of a chondrodysplasia punctata, but again, you can classify it if you see all the bones in detail. These are not just the stippled calcifications you see. So see, you see the shortened femora and the shortened humera. So that's all for the spotters. Thank you so much. I think quite a lot of students have answered all the spotters correctly. One or two were the difficult ones. Majority, though, they have answered it correctly.
Thank you, Dr. Manish. I think you can stop sharing your screen.
So okay.